Hello, my legion, and welcome back to Let's Play Banjo-Tooie. Now, I'm about 2 hours late doing commentary on this, because I had a very weird dream last night, which I may actually tell you guys about in a little bit, but it involved a giant snake and almost getting bitten and trying to save my dog. When I woke up from it, I could feel my heart pounding in my chest, and it was very, very, very unnerving, let's say. So I had to try and calm myself down before I did anything. Anyway, let's do the puzzle for the third level in this game, which is a world theme that we're going to be seeing at least once more in this game. And I don't mean by that carnival theme is going to be something we'll be revisiting. It's the fact that it's something that Gruntilda made and apparently runs, but we never knew of it until now. And yes, we are indeed the chosen one, but I'm not making you listen to the same dialogue over and over and over again. So for this level, and for every continuous level after this, I will be pretty much cutting out getting to Mumbo and any backtracking that I have to do throughout this level, because this, unlike a lot of the levels, is very circular. And while I don't want you guys to be confused where we are, I'll try and help fill you in. But first, Mega Globo, huh? Well, this will be important later, as in next level later, and we might be picking that up, we might not. I'm still kind of deciding. But before we head into the level, there are three signs that sit out here, and they're kind of entertaining, so let's read them. Clearly, we are dealing with a classy establishment here, but let's head in and actually get to work on the level, shall we? Now, before we start, I am going to say that I'm not going to be beating this level, much like the others, 100% the first run through, so we'll get to all of it later.
Oh,
right, yes, this is Boggy's wife, and she has lost her children, and we will be finding them periodically throughout the level. The first one can be a little hard to find sometimes, but for every playthrough that you do, they will have moved to different spots, so don't fret if you can't find them right off the bat. I'll be going over their locations once we find them all and send them back to their mothers. But anyway, the first child is right here. How do you get him to go back to his mother? You hit him. Damage him in any way. Alright, the kids are located in one of about five areas. Those being listed off are the Cave of Horrors, the Inferno, Crazy Castle, Space World, the Dodgem Dome, Area 51, which we are just in, and the Star Spinner, all of which are labeled in some way, shape, or form. And as you noticed, he didn't actually go to his mother, he left the theme park. I'm not entirely sure why they do. Now, I'm gonna be picking up something here that I've seen before but didn't actually show up. So here it is. Now, there are two honeycombs like this in the game. The first one that I'm showing off here is completely random. The second one that I can't actually remember if I've shown off is just straight up and down on your honeycomb bar. And I got extremely lucky there that it got all the way up. You can stop it at any time, as Jamjar said, with B, but I just chose not to. Anyway, this circus tent right here is important. Why? It's the boss fight. But first, that's right. In order to fight the boss, we need to find a grand total of 4 Big Top tickets. Now you may be wondering, where are these tickets? Well, we'll be getting them later once we get the Wumba transformation, mostly because that's the easiest way to get them. And I don't think this has been shown off in any Let's Play I've done. I may be entirely mistaken. Well, not that I've done, that I've seen, but you get the idea. Anyway, we do want to head up this particular tightrope right here, or I guess it's a stabilizing rope, whatever. You just need to climb up it as Kazooie. That being said, it's a little harder than you would think, considering that this is very, very, very small. Those will be important later. You can't get them until level 5, and in fact, one of the kids that is in this area, you can't get until level 5 anyway, so we won't be getting that jiggy until, you know, we come back here. This is the ability that the game was pretty much advertised with, splitting up Banjo and Kazooie. Now, as of right now, both of these guys are pretty much defenseless. We'll be getting more moves for them, obviously, as the game goes on, but In order just to show off their abilities as of right now, I'm gonna hit these switches. Yes, the Baron Bird can now literally be in two places at once. However, if you want to control the other one, you're gonna have to either be on another switch pad, or you're gonna have to be on a special glowing location that I will show off later in this entire level. So, Kazooie is lighter and faster. She doesn't take damage any easier, but she gets her attacking ability way later. For some reason. But yeah, this switch isn't actually back here. We actually saw it earlier when we hit that jump pad at the beginning of the level, so I'm gonna go back there and grab that. That's part of the reason why I decided to do this particular show-off like this. But anyway, if you're... I actually meant to do this video yesterday, but Arkham Knight came out and I got way distracted playing that, so forgive me. It has also been my birthday, so I have a slew of games to play. But regardless of how many games I have to play right now, I am going to be uploading at... I'm going to keep to my promise. I'm going to get better about uploading, and I am going to put up levels of Banjo-Kazooie every week that I can. And I'm also going to be playing through Five Nights at Freddy's just as much as I did, and I actually have a few... more videos Five Nights at Freddy's related in my head, but I'll get more into those later. You do want to pick up some fries right now, just because it's important for picking up one of the kids that you can actually get right now. Now let's talk about slot machines. Yep, the slot machines are where you get those tickets for the big top. Now, this is important because the slot machines can only be killed by a grenade egg or an equivalent attack. And since there are no equivalent attacks to the grenade egg, you're probably wondering what I mean by that. But we will get to that in a little bit. This is the Inferno area. This holds the Cave of Horrors and the Inferno, weirdly enough. But it also holds the High Dive for the, I guess, Thrill Seekers? But anyway, yeah, you can actually get a pretty decent view of all of Witchy World and the Skybox here, and I have to say, for N64, this is really impressive. I mean, it's not Kong Island, but this game actually does make the frame rate chug a little bit on your N64, so I can see why they released it for the Xbox and whatnot. Now, as you can see, you can't get to that jiggy just by jumping. You have to do the, backflip thing, and if you dive into the tank, there are 10 notes sitting at the bottom of it. I can respect this placement. It doesn't feel as dickish as some of the other notes later, but we'll be getting to that when we get to it. And yes, even though the slot machines are practically invincible, they still do respond. Oh yes, and there's always notes behind them, because of course there are. See, this is what I mean by dickish placement. This is the Wild West area, this is where Crazy Castle is, as well as Wamba's Wigwam, because cowboys and Indians is not technically racist, I think. I wouldn't know, I'm from the region where that's kind of a thing. But anyway, there is a Genjo just right up here, as well as back at the Big Top. I didn't mention it because I kind of figured that, you know, you guys were paying attention to the video. But first! This is the first Jiggy. What you have to do is you have to use 3 attacks of equivalent strength on it. First a grenade egg, then a ground pound, and then a beak drill. Now, most people are gonna realize that they have to slam down with the beak drill and the, ground pound. I've seen a lot of people not understand that you have to hit it with a grenade as well, and that's understandable, I guess, because it kind of feels a little bit like cheating, but that is your strongest attack as of right now. You will get, again, an equivalent one a little later, but first, let's go into the Crazy Castle Stockade. This area needs some help. You do want to fire a grenade egg over there. I don't believe that the Beak Barrage will help, but before we go into that particular area, we need to divide up and go see Jam Jars, since he's just right across the way with a white Genjo? Wait a minute, that's not right. Yeah, I picked up all the white Genjos. What the hell is this thing? Well, turns out... Yep, it's a Minjo, and now we can kill it with our backpack attack that we just learned from Jam Jars. Now, why the evil Genjos are called Minjos, I'm not 100% sure, but yes, they essentially look identical to Genjos. They change color depending on some random number algorithm, but... yeah, it's just a little bit weird. And these are the glowing areas that I mentioned earlier, being able to switch in between Banjo and Kazooie. If you stand on them and hit the jump button, I believe, or equivalent, you can swap over to your respective other member. And, unfortunately, Kazooie can also not do the backflip jump yet, so we're going to have to be dealing with that for a little bit. Kazooie becomes the most overpowered of the two, while Banjo becomes the most broken, if you ask me, if that makes any sense. But you'll see what I mean in later parts. But yeah, we won't be joining the bear and bird back together quite yet, because Kazooie does actually have her own game in the castle. So we'll be doing that before we move on to pretty much anywhere else. And yes, you can find one of the kids in here. Usually I find it's the girl, but again, it's completely random. So, we go into the left door over here because it is designed specifically for Kazooie.